The Foolish Mortals podcast is available now on YouTube and other streaming devices. Visit the link in the description down below for more moments like this.
You can't put a haunted church in the heart of America. That seems like a really strong message.
Happiest place on earth.
Welcome to Main Street USA, where everything is great. We've got hot dogs and popcorn. You can buy shirts made of American woven fabrics. And also, we have a church that's full of ghosts.
It really complements the bra shop we have just a few feet over that way. It's a great, we're going to Disneyland. It's a great place to have fun with your friends, view the world of tomorrow, and sin.
Tune in to the Foolish Mortals podcast now. I mean, no, not right now. Maybe do it after the video. Tell them Dallin sent you. From the studio that brought you Pirates of the Caribbean, It's a Small World, and The Haunted Mansion. Aw, man, don't tell me. Does this mansion happen to be haunted? Comes a brand new spooky, spine-tingling attraction that's fun for the whole family. Journey aboard a Doom Buggy 2.0 as you come face to face with all of the happy haunts in The Haunted Mansion 2. Relive all of your favorite memories from this timeless classic and experience some brand new thrills that you may not see coming. Wait, you mean to tell me they canceled all the annual passes? No! Offhand Disney presents a brand new adventure, The Haunted Mansion 2. Or more or less something like that. Now you may be thinking that when I talk about ride sequels, I'm talking about Phantom Manor to the Haunted Mansion, or Mystic Manor to Phantom Manor, or, hey, even Soarin' Around the World to Soarin' Over California, but that's not quite what we're looking at here. No, today instead we're going to be looking at certain attractions that went on to inspire other rides. They're not related in a story or theming fashion, but every other way, yeah, they're pretty much the same ride. Let's go ahead and start with the very first ride sequel and my personal favorite that existed at Disneyland. Yes, I do find a way to include it in every single video I make, and this one's going to be no different, but the Haunted Mansion was actually a successor to an already existing ride, this one in Tomorrowland. Adventure Through Inner Space opened in August of 1967 in the building that is currently occupied by Star Tours. And what does this ride all about shrinking you down to the size of the atom have to do with the Haunted Mansion? Not too much at face value, but when you look closer, you can start to see some similarities rear their heads. The ride was narrated by Paul Frees, the same man who lent his voice to the ghost host in the Haunted Mansion. This time though, he's less sinister, more scientific. And like the Haunted Mansion, Adventure Through Inner Space was an Omnimover style attraction. In other words, a ride system in where the ride vehicles were all attached to a belt that would move them all at the same time and were able to pivot in order to look at certain ride scenes at certain times. In this case though, instead of riding through a ghostly ballroom, you would ride in front of a giant snowflake before getting even smaller and becoming the size, again, of an atom. They were really obsessed with these things in the 60s. Even looking at the Omnimover vehicles themselves, they're just blue Doom Buggies. At least with the Little Mermaid, they decided to change them into clamshells, even though they're roughly the same shape. That ride doesn't feature Paul Frees, so it is not a ride sequel to the Haunted Mansion or Adventure Through Inner Space. Eventually, with the building and construction of the Haunted Mansion, they took what made Adventure Through Inner Space so good and sort of improved on it. And with the innovations in audio animatronic technology at the New York World's Fair in 1964, Disney used that to build more convincing sets and characters for the Haunted Mansion, which is why it remains today, and Adventure Through Inner Space sadly closed in 1985 to make room for Star Tours. But when you first enter the show building, you can see that the room you're in is essentially, you know, more or less the same as the Adventure Through Inner Space room. And I suppose if we're considering Haunted Mansion a sequel to Adventure Through Inner Space, we can also sort of consider Phantom Manor a sequel to the Haunted Mansion. But I've talked so much about these Haunted Mansion rides in the past that I feel like I don't need to go over it again. If you want to learn more though, check out my 31 Nights of the Haunted Mansion series, 31 videos of the Haunted Mansion for 31 straight days. Now there is one ride that is still operating today that I would consider sort of a half sequel to the Haunted Mansion, that's in Epcot, more specifically in Future World, or World Celebration is what we're calling it now.
spaceship Earth. What sets it apart from rides like Buzz Lightyear's Astro Blasters or The Little Mermaid is that there is a narrator. Sometimes they are faceless and have nothing really to do with the story of the ride, like in Adventure Through Inner Space and Spaceship Earth, but sometimes they're characters like the Haunted Mansion. But the sheer fact that this ride features no Paul Frees at all, come on Disney, put him in there somewhere. Just really anywhere, make him the Greek teacher. I'm sure he could speak Greek. No wait, he's dead? Oh.
I'll do it then.
That's why this ride is sort of a half-sequel to The Haunted Mansion. Not a full sequel, but, you know, sort of a half-step up. Let's move on, though, to one that may be a little more obvious to people who've been to both Disneyland and Walt Disney World. Again, yet another Epcot ride, Test Track, has been recreated multiple times around the globe, actually. See, now Test Track, both when it first opened and when it reopened with new theming, is a slot car-style dark ride. I mean, you remember slot cars from when you were a kid, those little tiny electrically charged little tiny cars that would zip around the track sometimes and sometimes just wouldn't move at all because the track wasn't working. Yeah, it's like that, but those cars are instead blown up to be life-size and people can sit in them and they can go up to 65, 70 miles an hour sometimes. The ride, when it opened in 1998, was an instant success and Disney knew right away that they wanted to recreate it for different parks. And so, in 2001, in Tokyo Disney Sea, Journey to the Center of the Earth opened. In this incarnation, instead of being a slot car though, it was a slot steam-powered mine vehicle. Now, Journey doesn't take advantage of speed as much as Test Track does because, you know, the theming is different. Until, of course, the very end when your car races away from a giant crab monster dinosaur thing in the center of the Earth. So Journey to the Center of the Earth at Tokyo Disney Sea was the second generation of Test Track rides, but there is a third, and it's way closer to home at Disney California Adventure in Anaheim. This time though, instead of being themed to a Jules Verne story or Crash Test Dummies or the City of the Future, it's themed to Disney Pixar's Cars and Cars Land. You guys know what I'm building up to here, Radiator Springs Racers. Now, of course, Test Track and Radiator Springs Racers aren't one-to-one copies of each other, but there are pieces that were taken from Test Track and put into this new version. Like, of course, the famous scene coming face-to-face with Mac or a semi-truck that almost hits you, but you swerve out of the way at the last moment. That was originally in Test Track, but they moved it over to Radiator Springs because it's such a cool effect and a cool scene that scares the life out of someone riding it for the first time. And of course, there's the one thing that all three rides have in common besides the ride vehicles, and that's the race at the end. At Epcot, it's a test of your vehicle's power, at Tokyo Disney Sea, you're trying to get away from a giant monster, and at California Adventure, it's of course just a good old-fashioned race. And up until this very day, those are the three different generations of Test Tracks you can find all over the world. Hopefully sometime soon we'll be able to get a fourth. I don't know where it would go, or what theme it would be, but I think this style of attraction perfectly captures the classic dark ride feel, while also putting a good amount of thrills in there as well. Maybe someday we'll get a high-speed version of the Haunted Mansion. That would be sort of weird, racing through a graveyard at the end of the ride. Actually, you know what, never mind, that sounds awesome. Now this next entry is another example of a Disneyland classic being updated and improved for Walt Disney World. In 1959, what used to be Holiday Hill at Disneyland was transformed into the Matterhorn Bobsleds, the first steel tubular roller coaster of its kind in the entire world. When the ride first opened, it was just a thrilling race down the icy slopes of the Matterhorn, but during its 1977 refurbishment, something new, or should I say someone new, was added. A new animatronic, an antagonist animatronic, if you will, was added, and he went by the name of Harold the Yeti, a malevolent presence that would follow guests through the Matterhorn as they tried to escape. Although I am getting ahead of myself, we do need to go back 2 years to 1975 when Space Mountain opened at Disney World. You see, over the years there had been a lot of talk of bringing Disneyland's Matterhorn into Walt Disney World and improving it somehow, although that never came to fruition. Mostly. The track and ride system to Disney World's Space Mountain is very, very similar to the Matterhorn, even though they're not identical. You can tell because after you get off Space Mountain, they have massage chairs in the gift shop because that ride will jostle you around very badly, just like the Matterhorn. It even features two tracks the way Disneyland's Matterhorn does, a Tomorrowland and a Fantasyland side, but at the Magic Kingdom, it's just a Tomorrowland side because the whole ride is in Tomorrowland. Eventually, a full-on spiritual successor to the Matterhorn was planned and approved for for Disney's Animal Kingdom. This time, instead of being a journey up the Matterhorn, you journeyed into the Forbidden Mountain. Expedition Everest opened in 2006 and was an immediate success, much like the Matterhorn and much like Space Mountain. People love riding a roller coaster through mountains. Who would have thought? Space, Thunder, Everest, Matterhorn, there's a running theme here. This was a highly, highly updated version of the Matterhorn and did not feature any of the same ride vehicles or tracks, but it did feature a Yeti, even though this one was a lot less animated than the one at Disneyland. So after 35 years, Disney finally got their Snowy Mountain roller coaster at Walt Disney World. It's just not a Matterhorn. Although there was a bigger, improved version of the actual Matterhorn bobsleds ride planned for the Germany Pavilion at Epcot before the sponsorship fell through and they never ended up building it, which I think would be cool to see, but hey, at least there's an alternate universe out there where we have Big Thunder Mountain, Space Mountain, Matterhorn Mountain, Expedition Everest, Fuji Coaster, and Disney World's Matterhorn all open and operating, and that is a universe I would like to be a part of. Now I have two more attractions that I want to talk about that have sequels, the first being the Indiana Jones Adventure at Disneyland. Now this ride, of course, if you ask any Disney fan, is one of the best attractions Disney has ever made in the Americas. The ride system, the theming, the thrills, all of it seems to be a new step up until Rise of the Resistance opened, but that's, you know, that's a separate story. And being such a massive success at Disneyland, Disney knew that they had to bring Indy in some way over to Walt Disney World in Florida. And they did. You know, kind of, in the form of Countdown to Extinction at Disney's Animal Kingdom. Now this ride, unlike everything else we've sort of talked about earlier, is the exact same track layout and ride system as Indiana Jones. Even though the track for Indiana Jones may be condensed because there is less space to work with at Disneyland, Countdown to Extinction, or as it's known today, Dinosaur, has the exact same amount of turns and stops and rolls as Indiana Jones does. The problem here being that the theming though is a lot weaker than Indy. Journeying back in time to save a dinosaur in the same ride system that Indiana Jones uses sounds like it would be an amazing experience, and it's an... it's an experience. The ride is in the pitch black darkness, I would say probably 70% of the time, and the other 30% of the time you're looking at the Carnotaurus just sort of leering at you from a distance. Sometimes it looks like he's trying to jump out at you, but not really. I can see why Disney is so hesitant to take this ride down though. There are good bones in this attraction. You can do something amazing with it. It's just not amazing right now. It really needs a test track style update, I think. Instead of an amazing effect of a boulder rolling down at you, going to crush you before you finally manage to speed past it, a Carnotaurus head is like mounted on a wall in front of you. He just kind of opens his mouth as you ride past. That's the grand finale of Dinosaur. So while Indiana Jones remains one of the best rides to experience at any of the Disney parks, Dinosaur is sort of its, you know, awkward little brother that hasn't quite found his stride yet. But hopefully one day, we'll grow into a very respectable young man. Disney, please update Dinosaur, please. We don't need Aladar as part of the ride. Nobody knows who Aladar is. I don't even know who Aladar is. What am I talking about? What's a dinosaur? Now there are many different ride sequels I did not mention in this video, like Horizons to the Carousel of Progress, or Big Thunder Mountain Railroad to Mine Train Through Nature's Wonderland, but I've been over that before. Let me know in the comments below, if you could make a sequel to one Disney attraction, what would you do? Would you make a Tangled-style boat ride in the fashion of Frozen Ever After, but without the projection faces? Or would you make an Ant-Man and the Wasp-style shooter ride similar to Buzz Lightyear's Astro Blaster? Oh, wait a second. Let me know in the comments, because you already know my answer is a sequel to The Haunted Mansion called The Haunted Mansion 2, Eddie Murphy Returns. Well, would you look at that? You've done it. You made it to the end of the video, all the way to the end card. Thank you for making it all the way through, and thanks for sticking around for this. If you are sticking around for the end card, make sure to leave a sort of code word in your comment to let me know you finished the video, like, I don't know, sandals. Put sandals in there somewhere, that's a good word. The names that you see floating by on the left-hand side are the names of my Patreon supporters. If you want to be among them and get early access to episode audio, and sometimes full videos like this one, use the link in the description down below, and even just $1 will get you access to 99% of the perks. Now, like I said at the beginning of the episode, make sure to take a look at my podcast with Disney Dan called Foolish Mortals, a Haunted Mansion podcast. Episode 1 is out right now, we're working on getting it out to more services, but it is available, and if you want to hear some fun history of the Haunted Mansion as told by me to Dan, head over to the link. I will link it also into the description down below. It's really fun, and it's a good time, and it's a little bit of offhand Disney after hours if you think you can handle it. So head over there. I would be very grateful if you checked out the YouTube channel as well. Make sure to follow me on Twitter for more updates around the channel or things that I'm thinking about when it comes to the Disney parks. And maybe stop by the Foolish Mortals Discord at some point, or the Offhand Disney Discord. They both exist, and even the subreddit is still somewhat active. So if you guys want to stop by there, have some conversations with your fellow Offhand Disney fans, watchers, and all-around enjoyers, that's going to be the place to do it. I think that's going to wrap it up, though, for this video, everybody. Everyone, thank you so much for watching this video on Disney ride sequels, and I'm looking forward to seeing you in the sequel to this video, Disney Ride Trilogies, maybe. Are there any Disney ride trilogies? Goodbye.